We're continuing on with our Laplace transform analysis of systems. So we got past this part here. I was doing the partial fraction expansion into the different parts, and then my computer died. But we talked about how A led to the time constant T sub C that characterized the system, or the rise time or the settling time. We did that last time, and these are things that are all defined in that handout by Nice on Laplace transforms and second order systems, or first order systems. So then the next kind of system that we talked about is the second order. And I don't believe I got to that. Is that correct? That we did not do that? Okay. So the second order. System in standard form. Looks like this with an input. F of S and an output X of S. So you can think of this as a mass spring damper system with an applied force. And then we track position X in the Laplace domain once you write the differential equation and it's put into standard form, looks like this. And the system is, one way to characterize it is by the damping ratio, zeta, and the natural frequency, omega n. And they're tied to the response. We'll walk through that. If we have a unit step input, then F of S is 1 over S. And then we can expand by partial fractions by the roots of the characteristic polynomial that we'll talk about here in a minute. So we're going to look at the roots of this thing here. We get an expression where we've put in the step input, and then we've factored the second order polynomial into two first order factors so that we can expand it out with partial fraction expansion. Into three factors. Like that. And of course, lambda 1 and lambda 2 are the roots of this second order polynomial, so you can find them from a quadratic formula. So there's minus b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4 times a, which is 1, because the s squared term doesn't have anything, and then c is omega n squared over 2a. So those are the roots. of that second order polynomial, and we can factor the 4 out and the 4 here, which is the 2 squared out of the square root, and we get a 2 out front. So that goes out. And that goes out. So there's the 2 out here. And then we can cancel like that. And then we have an omega n squared inside that we can pull outside. So we can simplify what these roots are. Like that. And if we look at this, because of the square root on this term, the damping ratio, or zeta, controls the response. If zeta is bigger than 1, then zeta squared is bigger than 1, and so the number under the square root is positive. If zeta gets less than 1, then it goes imaginary, and we'll take care of that. So we're going to walk through those different possibilities. You've probably done this in a controls class, but we're going to do it again because we'll get these values for an airplane mode, and we'll want to make sure that we know what different values of the damping ratio and natural frequency do. But the key is that the time response, if we're inverting this thing up here, inverse Laplace, even though we don't know what A, B, and C are, we know what the response is going to look like. And so we can see how lambda 1 and lambda 2 determine via the damping ratio what the response is going to be like. So we want to look at some cases. How are you guys doing? Are you caught up to this point where I can scroll? Do which way? Hold it there for a second. Yeah, okay. I'll start writing down here. We're going to do case 1, which is where the damping ratio is greater than 1. You good? Anybody else? Say the word now. So we're doing this case here. So if the damping ratio is greater than 1, you look at this thing here, and it's positive inside the radical. And so lambda 1 and lambda 2 are real, and they're negative. Why is that? Because you say, well, we got a plus and a minus here. I got a minus here. So obviously, if we got a minus and a minus, it's going to be negative. But what about this plus sign? Is this term over here on this side potentially bigger than this so that it could add to that negative number and give me a positive number? And the answer is no, because they both have omega n in there. But this one has a damping ratio squared under the radical, and then we take 1 away from that. So C squared minus 1 is going to be smaller than just C or zeta by itself. Because if you didn't have the 1 there, they would just cancel each other out. But since you're subtracting off some 1 there, we're going to get a negative number. So the roots are real and negative. And so if we plot those on the complex plane, which is always a good way to analyze roots, they're real and negative, so we got two roots that are over here. And they're not equal because of the plus and minus. If you look at the time response, it means we've got a negative number here and a negative number here. So the response is going to just rise up and then end up at a steady state value. Oh, sorry, not on this plot. I need to do a different plot. So the time response of X looks like that. It's well damped, and the damping is controlled by the negative numbers of lambda 1 and lambda 2. And the steady state value is going to be A. All right, so that's a nice response. If a gust comes along and hits our airplane and pushes it to, say, a different angle of attack, where X is now the angle of attack, we'd be okay with this. It's just a smooth response. It depends on how fast that happens as to how well we like it. But this case is called overdamped. Because these roots are not equal, and because the damping ratio is bigger than one, we call it overdamped. And the critically damped case is when the damping ratio is exactly equal to one. Because in that case, we go back up to the formula and we find out that these roots are equal. And they're equal to minus omega n, because we're going to go back up to our quadratic formula here. If the damping ratio is 1, that knocks that out, and the damping ratio is 1 here. So we just get minus omega n for both roots. So they're both negative. They're both real. Plot on the complex plane. They're both equal, so they're both over here. And the response still looks similar to the other case. But it turns out it's optimal. It's an optimal response because these two x's here are actually in between these two x's, and so you get the best damping from both roots. Okay, so that's case two. It's still got good behavior. Let's keep reducing the damping ratio. If I get ahead of you, say something. Case three, damping ratio less than one but greater than zero. And that means that thing under the square root sign is negative. So the square root is imaginary. And so to analyze this, we flip the sign under the radical and factor out a square root of minus 1, which is I. Right, I can do that. I just factored out a minus 1 out of that zeta squared minus 1, factored out a minus 1, and then pulled it outside the square root, and that becomes I. And this thing is now positive and real, so we're good. But what does this I thing do? And to analyze this, and keep track of stuff, we're going to name some things here. The real part here, we're going to call n. And the imaginary part, not including I, we're going to call omega, without the scribble there. So the roots with this definition are n plus or minus I omega. And it turns out we'll see that this is the frequency of an oscillation. And then this will determine whether it's damped or not. Because, go back up to the solution. Here's our inverse Laplace. We're going to plug those two lambdas in there in terms of n and omega and see what happens. So that's what we get. Those are the two roots in terms of the n and the omega. Then the inverse Laplace, I'm sorry, we've already inverted, my bad. This stays the same. And if you notice, there's an e to the nt in both of these terms, so that's what I want to factor out. All right, so this is the response. And we're going to look at this and we're going to say, all right, if n is negative, then e to the nt goes to zero as time becomes large. So that's good. That means it damps out. And if we look up here, based on the range of the damping ratio that we had defined up here, that is going to be a negative number because damping ratio is still positive and omega n is positive. So it looks like this thing's going to damp and n is going to determine how fast. But what happens to an e to the I omega t? And so we have to Google what that means, or we remember it from calculus or differential equations, or we look it up in our book, and we find out that the definition, what this means is and you may not look up just e to the omega t, what you'll probably find is e to the I theta defined in terms of some parameter theta is cosine theta plus I sine theta. So here's an important fascinating fact that you never know when you might use, but if somebody walked up to you on the street and said, I'll give you $1 million if you can prove that e to the I theta is cosine theta plus I sine theta, could you do it? Or could you tell them how it could be done? Probably not, right? Most people in math department could, and the way that this works is that you do a Taylor series expansion for cosine and sine. You guys know Taylor series, right? And you do a Taylor series expansion of e to the I theta And it turns out that the Taylor series for cosine and sine multiplied by I added together is the same thing as the Taylor series for e to the I theta. And that's how the math guys discovered this. So there you go. You might win $1 million. All right, the show is now back on. Who wants to be a millionaire? So who knows? That might be the question. I doubt it. Anyway, so that we'll take that as a definition because we trust the math guys. And I don't know what's popping up here. So what that means is that e to the I omega t and e to the minus I omega t are oscillatory. And what's the frequency? Frequency is radians per second. And that's exactly what omega is. Because the cosine of omega t has to be an angle, because you take cosine of an angle. And so omega t has to be radians. And since you're multiplying omega by t, omega has to be radians per second. And that is, you know how many seconds it takes to go from 0 to 2 pi, and that's one period of the cosine. So in this analysis, and that's what's nice about this, is when we find the motion of the aircraft and we get complex roots, real and imaginary parts, we know that the real part is going to tell us about the damping. And the imaginary part is going to tell us about how fast it oscillates or how fast it wiggles. And that's important if you hit a gust and you're trying to drink your Coke on an airplane. You want to know, well, is it damped? Does the gust hit it and then it damps back out to level flight? That's hopefully good, right? But also, how fast does the airplane oscillate? And if it does oscillate up and down, what's that going to do to the Coke on the tray table in front of you? Important stuff, right? So this case took a lot longer to analyze because the damping ratio is below that critically damped value of 1. And so then we get oscillatory behavior. But the nice thing is all we have to do is look at the roots and immediately we know, is it going to oscillate? Is it not going to oscillate? And all that stuff. And then the last case I'll show you is what happens when the damping ratio is exactly 0. And as you kind of could imagine, it's called the damping ratio for a reason. If it's gone, there is no damping. Because that first term, the minus damping ratio times omega n is 0. And the thing inside the radical is just minus 1. And so you get I omega n. So we'll scroll back up so you can see that exactly. We're talking about this thing here where the damping ratio is gone and this whole term is gone because the damping ratio is 0. And you really do get just a pure imaginary root, which is just pure oscillation. Anybody working on that I should leave that up for a second? I got this handy dandy button eraser here. So this is what you get, which means it's just pure oscillatory. N is 0, the real part is 0. So all you get are these things. And it just oscillates forever. Oh, I should be plotting these roots. We'll go back up and do the other one. So these roots are purely imaginary, no real parts, so they look like this. They're right on the axis there. And the response looks like this. Never damps out. What did we do? What? Because omega is omega n. right? We lost that part. And so the omega is just omega n when the damping ratio is zero. So if you want to call this omega, you can, but it is omega n. So less important than spilling your Coke is imagine being a pilot and trying to line up with the runway in gusty winds. And every time a gust comes along, your airplane pitches up and down like that. It's going to be hard to line up with the runway and touch down well if you get a really bad response. By the way, we need to draw that response for this thing up here where we had the damping between 0 and 1. And in that case, the roots look like this. And the time response looks like this. And it is damped, and that's damping, how fast that damps out depends on how big N is. So we started knowing the second order form in terms of natural frequency and damping ratio. But most of the time when you analyze roots of an airplane, you get the roots and they're not automatically in second order form. You just get a bunch of roots. So if you have the roots, how do you back out the natural frequency and the damping ratio? And so that's just a matter of turning the factored form back into a second order polynomial. So we're saying we're given this, we found that through an analysis. How do we find the natural frequency and damping ratio? Well, you multiply this thing out. Right, we have cross product terms, lambda 1s, lambda 2s. See, I need a minus sign here. All right, so you get S times S, and you get S times lambda 1, S times lambda 2, and then lambda 2 times lambda 1. So then we compare that to what we're looking for. We're saying let's put this in standard second order form. And so that's going to look like our standard form, like this. And so that means that this has to be this thing, and this has to be that thing. So all we have to do is equate those. So let's start with omega n squared is the product of the two. So we're going to plug in n plus or minus j omega. And make sure you get the results of this copied down, because in one of the homeworks later on, you'll need these formulas. And I don't think that it's clearly found in your book. So make sure you put this down somewhere. So if you start out with a set of roots, real and imaginary parts, this is how you get to damping ratio and natural frequency. Okay, so omega n squared is lambda 1 times lambda 2. So that means we have n plus j omega. So n minus j omega. So get you guys, your brains turned back on and some exercise mentally. Calculate that. Just multiply those products out and tell me what you get. I'll give you a couple minutes. And then the next thing you're going to do is we're going to compare the middle term to the sum of the two roots. So add those two together and come up with what that is. I'll give you a minute to do that. I just realized I jumped from I to J, didn't I? I apologize. I switched from being a mathematician to an electrical engineer. So typically math people use I think, and electrical engineers use J. So I apologize. When did I do that? Right here. So it's easy to make a J into an I. Although it looks kind of crappy. Looks worse. Here we go. How's that? There we go. So you're multiplying this out, n times n, and do the cross products, and then the final terms, right? So did you discover that there's not as many terms as you thought in that thing, right? So n times n is n squared. And I omega times I omega, the I times I gives you a minus 1, which cancels out with the minus 1. So you get omega squared, and I'm saying that's it. What happened to the other terms? Yeah, because it's a complex conjugate, and it turns out you always get complex conjugate roots. There's a math theorem that says if all the coefficients of a polynomial are real, you get complex conjugate roots. So that's nice. So that means omega n is the square root of that thing. And how about this one here? You add complex conjugate to itself, and it turns out the imaginary parts cancel out. All you get is that. So then we can back out the damping ratio once we've already calculated omega n up here. Do you mean this? Why did I put a 2 here? Oh, well, yeah, because there's 2 of those. My mistake. And that explains why on my paper this 2 is not here. Thank you. So if you're given roots, then you can calculate the damping ratio and natural frequency of your system. And then you can look up in the Federal Air Aviation Regulations, and it will tell you whether you have a good damping ratio and a good natural frequency for flight. Okay, we're almost done. The other key thing that you can do with the roots, based on our analysis, is that if you have any roots, so you have a set of roots, for a system, So now this doesn't have to be a second order or a first order. This could be a 10 millionth order system. You can say a lot about the system just by looking at the roots, because you look at the real parts. So look at the real parts. And then here's your conclusion. If all are negative, then it's damped. And it's called stable. Because you get an e to the minus some number times t, and that exponential goes to zero as time gets large. But you gotta have every single root negative, because all it takes is one bad root, and it spoils the whole bunch. Because all you need is one e to the plus something times t, and that's gonna go to infinity instead of zero. So the second conclusion is all are negative except one or more are zero, then it's not damped, but it's not, it doesn't explode. It's called marginally stable. Because it's on the borderline between stable and unstable. Because if we go to the next case here, all are negative except one or more are positive, then one of those is going to blow up and it's unstable. So you have a set of 100,000 roots. You look at all the real parts. If they're all negative, you're good. If all of them are negative except you see 1, 0, 1, then it's marginally stable. And if all are negative except you got one positive root or two positive roots, then those roots terms are going to blow up and the system blows up and it's unstable. And then if you have a non-zero imaginary part, then it's oscillatory. Because you get those e to the I omega t things that go into sines and cosines. And so the nice thing about all of this analysis is that you don't have to go back to the time domain. You can analyze all this in the Laplace. And I'm probably saying the exact same thing that you've talked about in 607, whenever you took it either now or earlier. In fact, in 607, not only do you analyze the stability of a system, but you actually design control systems in the Laplace domain because of this behavior. You know what the response looks like based on the behavior of the system and how the parameters in the controller change this behavior. So it's a very powerful tool for analysis and design. And we're 3 minutes from being out of time. I usually don't go this late, so we're gonna be done. A new homework set assigned due in a week and a half. So make sure you pull that up on Blackboard. In all honesty, you can't start it yet. I mean, you can if you're reading in the book. No, I apologize. Read the NIST handout and you can do the first couple problems. So you can start it now. It's Laplace transform stuff. The last two problems we'll be getting into next time.